past week, North Korea made headlines by threatening to launch a nuclear attack on U.S. targets in Hawaii, Guam, and even on mainland U.S. cities like Austin, Texas. Now, it's obvious to anybody who's familiar with North Korea's military capabilities that this would be a suicidal move. If they were foolish enough to follow through with such threats, North Korea would be reduced to a pile of smoldering rubble within a week. Understanding this, it would be easy to write off this saber-rattling as a desperate and poorly thought-out attempt to get attention. This is how the mainstream is painting it, and there may be some truth in this view. But let's look a little bit deeper. Why is North Korea behaving like this? What led up to this situation? Well, the obvious direct catalyst in this particular phase of the conflict was the U.S. military's decision to run bombing drills in South Korea with nuclear-capable B-2 bombers. These drills were explicitly designed to send a message to North Korea, as was clearly indicated by U.S. Defense Secretary Chuck Hagel when he made the following statement to the Pentagon. "We must make it clear that these provocations by the North are taken by us very seriously, and we'll respond to that." On a side note, Hagel is a member of the Council on Foreign Relations, an organization with a long history of promoting policies which have led to major wars of the past century, including Vietnam. The Council on Foreign Relations has also been pushing for military strikes on Iran. Now, to put this exchange into context, North Korea just recently went through a change of leadership. Kim Jong-il died, leaving his son Kim Jong-un in power. Kim Jong-un is young and completely inexperienced. In fact, he's the youngest head of state in the world. It's also worth noting that he was raised by a dictator in a society that treats the supreme leader as something of a god. So obviously the guy is a little off kilter. You could think of Kim Jong-un as the unbalanced, socially maladjusted trailer park kid that no one in school likes to talk to. Only problem is Kim Jong-un has a nuclear weapon, and he's proved that it works in recent detonations. It's a very small nuclear weapon, much less powerful than the bombs dropped by the U.S. on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and it's unclear whether he would actually be able to hit a U.S. target with his current technology. To put this in perspective, we have a socially maladjusted kid with a 22 pistol who's fired off a few rounds behind his trailer. The United States in this scenario has played the part of Earl, the local trailer park bully. And Earl has decided to make an impression on the socially maladjusted kid by parading around his trailer firing off an AK-47. This after cutting off the gas and electricity to the trailer. By this, I'm of course referring to the sanctions. Overall, it's not real smart. That is, unless Earl actually wants the kid to do something stupid. And that may in fact be the case. Now, these bomber drills by the U.S. are only the latest in a series of aggressive measures taken against North Korea. Each stage of Korea's progress towards becoming a nuclear power has been met with sanctions, starting with economic and trading sanctions in 2006 in response to their first nuclear test, and tightening those sanctions further in 2013. For North Korea, which is already economically weak, with two-thirds of its population already suffering from periodic food shortages, these moves are serious acts of aggression. This is a point that most Westerners don't take into account. A lot of people tend to think that sanctions are a non-violent measure, but the reality is sanctions are an act of war, and it's the civilian population that pays. We saw this clearly in the Iraq sanctions, which led to the deaths of over 500,000 children.
We have heard that 500,000 children have died. I mean, that's more children than died in Hiroshima. And you know, is the price worth it? I think this is a very hard choice, but we think the price is worth it.
To bring this closer to home, imagine, for example, that the European Union decided to convince the UN to impose sanctions on the U.S. Now imagine these sanctions involve cutting off all U.S. imports, banning any business dealings with U.S. companies, freezing U.S. assets and bank accounts, and preventing resources from being shipped to the U.S. Obviously, this would wreak economic havoc on America. People would lose jobs, many would become homeless, and if the sanctions were severe enough, people would die. How would the U.S. respond to something like that? How would the American people respond? It should be clear that this would lead to calls for war. And given our track record, there would probably be military strikes in progress within a month. So why would we expect anything else from North Korea? What we're seeing here is a policy of provocation. But why? What is the U.S. trying to achieve? Both China and Russia have both issued warnings this week stating that these recent drills by the U.S. and South Korea were escalating tensions and that the situation could easily spiral out of control. Already it has led North Korea to nullify the armistice with South Korea, effectively reopening a 60-year-old war. If North Korea is foolish enough to actually engage the United States or South Korea, this would give them the pretext to invade and destroy the North Korean regime. Geopolitically, this would be a major blow to China because it would remove the buffer zone that North Korea provides, and it would give the U.S. military bases right on the Chinese border. As insane as this may sound, if luring North Korea into a conflict is indeed the goal of the U.S., it would be in keeping with America's ongoing policy of encircling China. China has already expressed anger this past year at the establishment of a new permanent military base in Australia and America's recent push to strengthen military relationships with a number of Southeast Asian countries. China interprets these moves as military encirclement. And Obama seemed to confirm that this was the case when he stated in 2011 that there will be times when Beijing does not play by the rules, and the U.S. will send a clear message that they need to be on track in accepting the rules and responsibilities that come with being a world power. Meaning, do what we say or else? It's kind of hard to see how that would be interpreted any other way. Viewed by itself, this may seem like a return to Cold War tension and maneuvers. However, when looking at the big picture, it becomes clear that this is part of a larger escalation towards a global conflict. Operation Dagger is already underway, and the U.S. is positioning itself in 35 African countries. In Syria, the U.S. has now stated openly that it's going to begin aiding the rebels to help oust Assad. Of course, the U.S. has been aiding the rebels covertly for some time now, so this just represents an escalation. All the while, a new round of saber-rattling towards Iran begins. To understand the driving force behind these events, please watch my mini-documentary entitled The Road to World War III. If you'd like more content like this, please subscribe to this channel, Storm Clouds Gathering, on YouTube. We have new prepared videos on Monday and Wednesday. We now have a live YouTube broadcast at Tuesday, 9 p.m. Eastern. For updates and bonus content, please follow us on Facebook, facebook.com/Storm Clouds Gathering, on Twitter at Collapse Updates, and our website, StormCloudsGathering.com.